Welcome everyone to the Barcelona Mathematics and Machine Learning Colloquium Series. This is an activity organized by the Department of Mathematics of the Autonomous University of Barcelona. We do this having in mind all our other institutions in Barcelona, but not only them, also the global community. And in this edition, we were happy to see people from all over the world sign up to attend these talks. What is this colloquium? So we want to answer two questions. What are the mathematics behind machine learning and what can machine learning do for mathematicians? When and where we do it, it's only three times a year, it's online, and you have all the information on our website. How? So as we are going to do today, we'll have a talk and then a discussion. Feel free to ask at any time using any of the buttons that may appear on Teams. And most importantly, who? So last year, we were very honored to have three great speakers, and you can find actually talks, the videos of the talks and the slides on our website. And this year, I think we are even luckier to have other three great speakers. And today, it's the turn of our first speaker, Laurent Laforgue. So Laurent Laforgue won the Fields Medal in 2002 for his work on the Langlands program. And he was working as a pure mathematician, say, in the one of the most prestigious institutions in the world, IHS. But a few years ago, moved to Huawei Research Center in Paris. So we are indeed very curious to know what he has been up to in this last years, combining his purely mathematical background with some applications. So he will talk about some sketches for a topos theoretic AI. So enjoy the talk. And Laurent, thanks a lot for accepting our invitation. And the floor is yours.
Okay, so thank you very much for the invitation. So I share my slides. So here you see them?
Yes, we see them.
Screen mode, is it okay?
Perfect.
Okay. Okay, so thank you very much for the invitation. So as you mentioned, I am a pure mathematician and I spent almost my whole career in the academic world. And then I moved to Huawei in 2 years and a half ago. In fact, it happened by chance. So I met some people from Huawei. They invited me, I think 7 years ago, to give a talk in a conference on applications of mathematics. And I decided to give a talk on topos theory because I had become very interested into this subject. And to my huge surprise, what I said arose the interest of some Huawei engineers who were attending the conference. And some of them began to seriously study the subject. And by now, at the Paris Huawei Research Center, there are several people working on topos theory in the perspective of AI. So because some basic facts of topos theory gave to them and, the idea that the theory of quotientic toposis could become most useful for the development of AI. So the talk I am going to present today gives some basic general ideas about that. We'll explain at least part of what we are trying to implement, and on the basis of some basic features of topos theory. So of course, I suppose that most of you, excuse me. Yeah, most of you don't know topos theory. So this means that in my slides, I will have to recall many basic facts. So I will try to go quickly on that. Anyway, after that, you will have the slides and you will be able to come back to the definitions and try to understand more with more precision. I hope that you will be able to understand at least part of what I am going to say. So let's begin with starting remarks about the most important problem, which is the problem of representing elements of reality. So here we have the question, how can elements of reality be represented in computers? So for instance, think about images or phenomena. Okay. And there are some obvious conditions to verify. These representations have to allow storage and they have to allow processing, especially processes of information extraction. So this has obvious consequences. So representations of elements of reality in computers have to consist into finite sequences of symbols. Of course, the symbols may be numbers, but not necessarily. This is important to remember. The different symbols that may appear can be called words. So here I make the remark that any number is a name, but of course, names are not necessarily numbers. And we also need grammar rules, or if you prefer, axioms, expressing identities or equivalences between different expressions. Indeed, without axioms, there would be no computing process. Of course, we need formal languages where the list of symbols, the list of names, and the list of grammar rules, of axioms, are fully explicit. Indeed, when we deal with computers, we can only try to implement mathematical models. And in mathematics, everything has to be explicit. Comes a more specific problem, which is most interesting in itself. How to represent elements of reality in a way which expresses the fact that they belong to a common family. For instance, we can think about images. Of course, there are many different images, but they are all images. And how to express this fact? There are some obvious conditions. In order to express elements of reality who belong to the same family, so we need to do this, but at the same time, we need to represent different elements of reality by different representations. So we need the two things at the same time. The fact that they belong to some natural family and the fact that they are different from each other. So these two things have to be represented in computers. So because of our experience with natural languages, we can say the following. So a natural way to express the fact that a series of elements of reality belong to the same family is to describe them by using the same vocabulary, the same list of words. In other words, they should all be represented by a joint description language, consisting in a joint vocabulary and a collection, a family of joint grammar rules. But each particular element of reality should be distinguished from the others by additional specific grammar rules. So here I make the remark that, of course, when we represent elements of reality by numbers or collection of numbers, any specific element will be determined by setting coordinates. But it is only one possible way to make some grammar rules more precise. So once again, mathematics does not consist only in dealing with numbers. This is important to remember. We have to allow ourselves this freedom. Okay, so by now, as I said, we need a notion of or notions of formalized language. So here, I have given on this slide a general notion of formalized language, which is so-called first-order geometric theory. So it is a particular type of logic, which I have chosen because it is directly related to topos theory. So topos theory, as I shall explain, is an extremely general form of geometry, much more general than all existing theories in geometry. And this extremely general form of geometric objects is related, as I will recall, to some specific form of logic, a formal language, which is first-order geometric theory. So here I have put in the definition that this is a general notion of theory consisting in a vocabulary, a list of words, and a list of axioms. So here I have made precise that the vocabulary, in fact, has to consist into three types of words. There are words which are, in some sense, names of objects, words, or if you prefer, names of sets, when you are thinking about set theoretic models. There are words which are names of maps, and there are words which are names of relations. And there are axioms, and the axioms always have the form of implications between two formulas in the same finite family of variables. The variables have to be attached to names of objects, and the formulas are formed from the map names and the relation names by using logical symbols. So the symbol for images, which is existential quantifier, the symbol for arbitrary unions, and the symbol for finite intersections. So the reason why we allow these symbols is that they are well adapted to general geometric transforms, which I am going to talk about very soon. Okay, so this is the notion, the general notion of theory we are considering. And then we have the notion of model. So logic is structured by the relationship of formal theories, so this is called syntax, and models, and this is called semantics. So so this, of course, is parallel to the usual relationship between natural languages and elements of reality to which natural languages apply. We use words to talk about things which exist and which we know. Okay, so this relationship between natural languages and elements reality, which natural languages allow to talk about, inspires a mathematical relationship between, on the one hand, formal languages, consisting in a vocabulary, a list of words, and a list of axioms, on the one hand, and on the other hand, the models of such a theory. So here I have written the definition of a model. For instance, so here, okay, this is the formal definition, but maybe you can read the definition. But in order to understand it, the best thing to do is to think about examples. So for instance, if you think about group theory, so group theory as a formal object of logic consists in a few list of words. So there is the word group, there is the word multiplication law, there is the word inverse, there is the word unit element, and that's all. There are axioms, so for instance, the fact that multiplication is associative, that the unit element is a unit, that the product of an element and its inverse is a unit, so things like that. Here, in fact, I already said the full list of axioms. And then what is a model? A set-valued model is just a set endowed with a structure of group. So this means it is endowed with a unit element, with a multiplication law, and with a law for replacing elements with their inverse, verifying the axioms of group theory. So this is the notion of set-valued index. By now, for people who know category theory, it can be remarked that the notion of model makes sense in a more general context, which is the context of a category which verifies some structural properties. So finite products have to be well defined, as well as fiber products. Morphisms need to have well-defined images. Arbitrary unions and finite intersections of subobjects have to be well-defined. And the functors of fiber products have to respect the formation of images, of unions, and of finite intersections. Okay, so when you have a category where these properties are verified, you can talk about models of a geometric theory in such a category. And this model make up a category for any such category. So the categories which verify these properties can be called geometric, because they allow for the notion of model of a geometric theory to make sense in such a category. Okay, so here is a first example of a geometric theory. You start from any small category, and you consider the associated category or so-called presheaves, which means diagrams indexed by the category C, or by its opposite, in fact, of sets. Okay, so you have to associate to any object of C a set, and to any morphism of C a map in the reverse direction. So these are called presheaves, and they make up a category which is traditionally denoted C hat. And why is it denoted C hat? It is because there is a natural embedding of C into C hat, and C hat, in some very precise sense, can be considered as a completion of C. And here we have the properties that all categories of diagrams, all categories C hat, are geometric. So we can talk about the category of models in such a category of any geometric theory T. Okay, and in fact, a model in such a category is just a diagram of set-valued models. Okay, so by now, we progressively move to topology, and we remark that for a geometric theory T, there is a well-defined notion of continuous family of models of T, parameterized by a topological space X. So this is the category of models of T with values in the topos of sheaves of sets on X. So I will immediately say what it is. The important fact is that for any point of the of such a topological space X, so let's call it small x, there is an evaluation functor which allows, given any model of T inside this topos, to evaluate it at this point. And in this way, the evaluation at any point becomes a set-valued model of our geometric theory T. Okay, and the global object can be considered as a continuous family of models. More generally, for any continuous map from F, from a topological space X prime to a topological space X, there is a functor of change of parameters which replaces the parameter in X by the parameter in X prime. So this is a pullback functor. It goes to the reverse direction of F. Okay, so here I have written a justification for that. I explain that when we have a topological space, we can associate to it the category of open subsets on in of X together with inclusions between open subsets. So this is some particular type of category. So we have the category of pre-sheaves on this category O of X, and a sheaf is just a pre-sheaf which verifies some gluing condition with respect to the notion of coverings of a big open subset by smaller open subsets. Okay, so here I have not recalled the definition of gluing. Okay, so this is I just pronounced the word. Okay, but the important point is that for any topological space X, the category of sheaves shares all constructive properties of the category of sets. It is just as good to do mathematics. So in particular, it is geometric. And we have the extra properties that for any continuous map between two topological spaces, the associated categories of sheaves, so the associated toposes, as they are called, are related by a pair of adjoint functors. And the first element of this pair, the pullback functor, which is left adjoint to the other component, respects not only arbitrary colimits, but also finite limits. So this means it respects finite products and fiber products in addition to sums, arbitrary sums and quotients. Okay, and by now, you see we have these two families in mind. On the one hand, the categories of diagrams, and on the other hand, categories of sheaves on a topological space. And here comes the wonderful definition introduced by Grothendieck, which is a joint generalization of categories of diagrams on the one hand and categories of sheaves on the topological space on the other hand. So here is the definition. We consider, we start with the small category. So a topology on such a category is just a notion of covering families of objects by morphism targeting this object. So we choose for any object X, which families of morphism targeting X are covering or not. And this definition, in order to be considered a topology, has to verify three properties, ABC, which I have written on this slide. So the identity morphism of any object has to be a covering. Pearl backs have to transform coverings into a covering. This is a so-called stability property. And lastly, a covering of a covering is a covering. So when we have such a notion of covering, it defines a notion of sheaf. So a sheaf is a pre-sheaf, which means a diagram of sets indexed by the opposite category of C, which verifies some gluing condition, which I have not written, but this gluing condition is phrased in terms of coverings. It is relative to the notion of covering. And then the sheaves with respect to such a topology J make up a full subcategory of the category of pre-sheaves. So I have written it C at J because it can also be considered as some kind of completion of the category C. And lastly, by definition, a topos is just a category which is equivalent to the category of sheaves on some category C endowed with a topology J. With a remark here that in general, this representation is not unique, but as soon as there is such an equivalent, such a category E is called a topos. So a topos is a category which can be constructed as a category of sheaves on some small category C endowed with a Grothendieck topology. Okay, and by now we have the fact that any topos has the same constructive properties as the category of set. So Grothendieck says that toposes are pastiches of the category of sets. In fact, there is a reverse, a reciprocal statement to this proposition. So this is a theorem which had been proved by a student of Grothendieck, Giraud, which says that when a category has the same constructive properties as the category of sets, it is a topos. So it is a way to characterize toposes. And so, in particular, toposes are geometric categories. And so, we can, for any geometric theory T, define and consider the category of models with values in such a topos E of the theory T. And we have as many such categories of models as there are toposes. So you see, there is not only the category of set-valued models, but there are the category of models of T with values in arbitrary toposes. And most of the time, in fact, this category of models become even more interesting than the category of set-valued models. And these categories are related one to the other. They form a network of categories. So the reason is because there is a notion of morphism of toposes. So here I have written the definition, a morphism of toposes by definition is a pair of adjoint functors. So the left adjoint part is a pullback component going in the reverse direction. And the right adjoint part is a push forward component. And by the definition, it is required that the pullback component respects not only arbitrary colimits, but also finite limits, which means finite products and fiber products. Okay, and here there is a remark, which is a justification for this definition. It is the fact that if we have two topological spaces, and so X and X prime, and X is so-called sober. So I will not recall the definition of sober. Let's just say that all topological spaces which naturally appear in mathematical practice are sober. So when we have such topological spaces, to consider a morphism of toposes between the toposes of sheaves on X prime on X is the same thing has to consider a continuous map from x prime to x. So this means we have translated the notion, the topological notion of continuous map in the language of category theory, with the advantage that on the category theory sides, there are many more toposes than there are topological spaces. So this means that we have replaced the category of topological spaces and continuous maps with a much bigger category, the category of toposes and morphism of toposes, which in fact is just as good to do topology. So this is why, in fact, Grothendieck chose the name topos, meaning that he thought that topology should become the science of toposes, just because it was for him the most general notion of topological space. Just by definition, the pullback components of morphism of toposes respect arbitrary colimits and finite limits, and this is enough for them to define functors of change of parameters of models of T. So this means that when we consider a geometric theory T, not only any toposes EE prime give rise to categories of models of T in E and E prime, but morphism of toposes F from E prime to E define functors in the reverse direction from the category of models of T in E to the category of models of T in E prime. So these are, if you want, change of parameters functors. Okay, and by now, we have the following theorem, which in fact has been proved in the mid-70s by many people. Mackay, Reyes, Joyal, Benabou, I think Lowyer also played the role. So many people contributed to this theorem. In fact, on the basis of the first examples, which were given in the PhD thesis of Monique Hakim, who was a student of Grothendieck. So this theorem, is just an extension of something which had already been seen by Grothendieck. So here is this theorem. Consider an arbitrary geometric theory. So by definition of semantics, in the sense of the logician Tarski, its semantic consists in the network of its categories of models, parametrized by toposes and related by the functors of change of parameters defined by topos morphism. Then, this semantics is incarnated by a topos in the following sense. So consider an arbitrary geometric theory. Then, it is possible to associate to it a so-called classifying topos, ET, which is unique up to equivalence, and which is endowed with a particular model, UT of the theory T, with values in ET, and it will be called the universal model of T, characterized by the property that for any topos E, the operation which consists in considering the pullbacks of the universal models by all geometric morphism, all morphism of toposes from E to ET, defines an equivalence from the category of morphism from E to ET to the category of models of T with values in the topos E. So you see, so I repeat because it is really extraordinary, that according to this theorem, the models of T with values in an arbitrary topos are reinterpreted as the morphism from this topos E to the classifying topos. So this theorem allows to incarnate the semantics of an arbitrary geometric T into a geometric object, a topological object, which in fact is a topos. And of course, this theorem would not be possible if we had remained with topological spaces in the classical sense. So here I make the remark that a particular case of that, of course, is when E is the simplest of all toposes, which is the category of sets. So in that case, what you get is that the set-valued models of T are reinterpreted as the topos morphism of set to the classifying topos. And by definition, in topos theory, the morphism from set to a topos are called the points of this topos. So you see that you are translating the notion of set-valued models into the notion of point. Okay. By now, we can be a little more precise, just building on this equivalence. And we realize that this construction gives us a topological interpretation of syntax. So syntax, once again, consists in the formal definition of a theory. The list of its names, its vocabulary on the one hand, and its axioms on the other hand. So we see that, in particular, the names of objects interpret as objects in the classifying topos. The symbols of maps interpret as morphism in this topos. The symbols of relations interpret as sub-objects in this topos. The formulas interpret also as sub-objects in this topos. And conversely, all sub-objects of objects of the topos, which are products of objects associated to names, to the so-called source of the language of the theory, so all these subjects are defined by formulas. So this is some kind of equivalence between syntax and semantics in the universal topos. And we have that an implication between two formulas is provable in the theory if and only if it is verified by the universal model. So we can also describe by now we see that formulas become objects in the topos. So when we have two formulas, they are reinterpreted as two objects. And we can wonder what are the morphism in the topos between these two objects. And they interpret as formulas, which verify the property to be so-called provably functional. So when I say provably functional, of course, it is with respect to the axioms of the theory T. There is also in this topos a notion of covering. A family of morphism is called a covering when the target object is the union of the images of this morphism. And this can be expressed here purely in syntactic terms. So you see here the syntax incarnates as some subcategory of this classifying topos. So this category is called the syntactic category of the theory. It can be defined purely in syntactic terms, and it is endowed with a natural Grothendieck topology. And in fact, the classifying topos is constructed as a topos of sheaves on this category with respect to this topology. Okay, so here I come back to what I had already said, that in this relationship between a theory and its classifying topos, the points correspond to set-valued models. This is because the category of points of a topos is defined as the category of morphism from the topos of sets to our topos E. More generally, if you consider two toposes E, E prime, the morphism from E prime to E can be called the category of points of E parameterized by E prime. So this is a generalized notion of moving point, of parameterized point. Okay, and then we have the following theorem, which is a reverse theorem with respect to the previous one. Consider an arbitrary topos presented as a topos of sheaves on some category C endowed with a grothendieck topology J. Then this pair CJ defines a geometric theory TCJ such that the names of objects of TCJ are just the objects of C. The names of maps of TCJ are just the morphism of C. There is no relation name in this theory. And for any topos E prime, the category of E prime parameterized points of E identifies with the category of models of this theory with values in E prime. So you see, we have two theorems. So this one, which allows to go from logic to topology. And in the reverse direction, there is this theorem, which allows to go from topology to logic. Okay, and this is why we have introduced this notion of geometric theory. This is because, thanks to this theorem, it relates logic and topology in the generalized sense of topos theory. Okay, so by now, we arrive to the core of the talk with the following, of course, general topological notion, which makes sense in the general context of a topos. So of course, when we think about a topological space, of course, we are used to the fact that a topological space has subspaces. But the notion of subspace generalizes to the notion of subtopos. So here is a definition. So the definition, of course, is phrased in terms of category theory, so it is a little technical. But in fact, when we have a subspace of a topological space, it induces a subtopos in this sense. And this is the reason for this definition. Okay, and by now we have the following theorem. We have two theorems, in fact. So the first one is that if a topos is presented as a topos of sheaves on a site, which means a pair consisting in a small category C endowed with a grothendieck topology J, then to consider a subtoposis E prime of E is the same thing as to consider a topology J prime on C, which is more refined than J. So this means that there are more coverings, more J prime coverings than J coverings. And so this means that we are able to express the notion of subtopos in terms of topologies. But on the other hand, there is this other theorem, which is taken from the PhD thesis of Olivia Caramello, which tells us that when a topos E is presented no more by a site, but by a geometric theory, which means if it is written as a topos, as a classifying topos of some theory T, then to consider a subtopos E prime of E is equivalent to considering a quotient theory T prime of T up to syntactic equivalence. So what does it mean, quotient theory? It means a theory with the same vocabulary, but more axioms. You take the same axioms, but you allow yourself to add new axioms. And you say that two categories in the same vocabulary, with the same vocabulary, are syntactically equivalent when any implication which is provable in one of these theories is also provable in the other one. So they have the same collection of provable implications between formulas. Okay, and so you see that according to these theorems, going through the bridge of a topos, as Olivier Caramello would say, there is an equivalence between quotient theories of a given theory and refined topologies of a given topology on some category. So it, in particular, these two theorems allow to transform provability problems in first order logic into problems of generation of Grothendieck topologies. Okay, so we need a little more information for a little more topological definitions. So here is a definition of submersion between two topologies. So here I give a technical definition, but the important fact is that this technical definition generalizes the notion of submersion between two topological spaces. And by now, we have the general proposition that any morphism between two topologies uniquely factorizes as the composite of a submersion and an embedding. And of course, the intermediate object is called the image of the morphism F. The image is included in the subtopos of the target topos E. Okay, so you have this general proposition, and as always in topos theory, you may wonder, what does it mean on the logical side? So here, suppose your target topos E is written as a classifying topos of some geometric theory T. And consider and suppose that your morphism F from E prime to E, which means from E prime to ET, corresponds to a model of T in the topos E prime. Then you may wonder, what is the quotient theory T prime of T, which corresponds to the image of F? And the answer is that it is the theory of M, in the sense that any implication between two formulas is provable in this quotient theory T prime if and only if it is verified by the model M, which means that the interpretations of the two formulas, phi and psi, considered as sub-object of the same object in E prime, are related by an inclusion. Okay, so the theory of M is the quotient theory of T, so this means you keep the same vocabulary, but you add as axioms all implications between formulas which are verified by the model. Okay, so this is everything I wanted to recall on the basics of topos theory. And by now, what I am saying is that all these basic definitions and the correspondence it establishes between logic, which means formalized languages, and topology, allow to propose a scheme for a general scheme for what we would call syntactic learning. So suppose we start with elements of reality EI. So in general, of course, we never fully know elements of reality. So suppose that partial knowledge on these elements of reality is incarnated by some sites, CI, JI. But of course, we want this partial knowledge to be storable in computers. So this means that the sites necessarily have to be presentable by finite data. So this means that, for instance, the category CI may be finite, or more generally, just finitely presentable, or finitely presented. Okay, and then we suppose that all these elements of reality EIs belong to a natural family. So this should translate into the existence of a joint description geometric theory T, such that each partial knowledge pair CIJI is endowed with a morphism from the associated topos to the classifying topos of T. It means exactly that these pairs CIJI are, we suppose that they can be interpreted as models of the theory T in the topos defined by these pairs. Okay, so suppose we are in this situation, then all the morphism FIs have images. The images are subtoposes of ET, and this means that the that this subtoposes of ET should be written as the classifying toposes of some quotient theory TIs of T. So these quotient theories can be considered as singular descriptions of the elements of reality EIs in the joint description formal language T. So you see that the descriptions of all these different elements of reality belonging to the same family should take the form of subtoposes of the same topos, which is a classifying topos of the description language of this type of elements of reality. Of course, when you see things as subtoposes of a same topos, you may think, but okay, for instance, it may happen that a subtopos is smaller than another small subtopos. So this means that you may have this inclusion relation. So what does it mean? It would just mean that two descriptions would be related by the fact that one of them is more precise than the other. And of course, this type of relation happens all the time. So for instance, if you think about images, you may have two images of the same object, but one image is just more precise than the other. For instance, its resolution is finer. Okay, so by now, something we want to do, that's why we are interested in computations. In particular, we would want to be able to extract information. So for this, we need operations on languages, on description languages. But we are guided by toposes. So you see, the relationship between formal languages taking the form of geometric theories on toposes is that toposes incarnate the semantics of the theories. So this means that a guide for everything we want to do is that we want to work all the time at the syntactic level, because anyway, in a computer, you can only have syntax, but we want to only perform operations which are well defined at the level of toposes. Because what it will mean is that these operations are meaningful. So the problem of syntax is that syntax by itself is meaningless. In order to retain meaning, you have to consider the semantics of the formal languages. And the semantics, according to this theorem, I have stated a few pages before, takes a topological form, more precisely the form of a topos. So everything by now we have a guide for what we want to do. We want to perform operations which are well defined at the level of toposes, of morphism of toposes, and of subtoposes. So here we consider the operations, the natural operations on subtoposes we may have. So first, there is a remark that for any topos, its subtoposes form an ordered set. So it is a set and it is ordered by inclusion. By now, if we choose a family of subtoposes in this set, this family also always have a well-defined union and a well-defined intersection. We also have that finite unions are distributive with respect to arbitrary intersection. And we have the possibility to form complements. So here I have written the precise definition. So all of these are very important operations on subtoposes. And of course, a most important fact is that as soon as these operations are well defined in the world of toposes, they induce operations in the world of theories. So you can talk about the join of theories, an intersection of theories, complements of theories, and things like that. Then, another most important construction is the following. So you consider an arbitrary topos morphism, and then you say that such a topos morphism induces a push-forward map of subtoposes. This is because if you consider a subtopos of our topos E prime, then we can consider the composite of the embedding of this subtopos in E prime with the map F from E prime to E. The image of that is a subtopos of E. And this associates to any subtopos of E prime, a subtopos of E. And this construction respects, in fact, arbitrary unions of subtoposes. The image of a union is the union of the images. And there is also a pullback functor which transforms subtoposes of E, the target topos, into subtoposes of E prime, the source topos. And these two operations, the push forward operation and the pullback operation, are characterized one by the other, by the formula I have written. So we have that the pullback operations respects arbitrary intersections and also finite unions. And lastly, there is an important remark that if the morphism F from E prime to E verifies an extra property, which is called to be essential, in the sense that its pullback component respects not only finite limits, but arbitrary limits, then the map F minus one on subtoposes is complemented not only with the push forward map F lower star, which is some kind of geometric incarnation of the existential quantifier, but also another map, which I have written F with an exclamation dot, which is a geometric equivalent, a geometric incarnation of the universal quantifier. Okay, and here I have written a formula characterizing this new operation. So by now, let's come back to the problem of elaborating a job description language for some type of elements of reality. So we start with a family of elements of reality, EI, which we don't know. As they are elements of reality, we can consider that these elements of reality incarnate some semantic content. So we may suppose, just as a mathematical hypothesis, that they have a topos structure. This is because in our mathematical model, semantics is always incarnated by a topos. So for us, any element of reality is seen as a topos, and a topos which is unknown. But we think we may have partial knowledge on each element of reality. So this should take the form of a category CI presented by finite data, endowed with a functor from CI to EI. So this just means that in these mostly unknown elements of reality EIs, we have been able, or we are able, to identify some elements. We recognize some elements. We don't identify everything. There are many things which we don't see, which we don't understand, but we have partial knowledge, partial identification, and they take such a form. By now, the fact that all EIs belong to a natural family should translate into the existence of a joint description vocabulary, which I have written sigma, and naming functors, with NIs, which go from the CIs to the C sigma. So this means that to any object of or morphism of CI, we are able to associate a name, or more generally, a formula, in terms of the vocabulary sigma. So once again, in sigma, there is no axiom. It is just a vocabulary. So here, the scheme which is proposed on this slide just means that on each element of reality EI, we are able to recognize some elements, and we use for these elements a description vocabulary, which is the same for all elements in the family. Okay, so by now, just for categorical reasons, each such naming functor NI defines a topos morphism from the topos of presheaves on CI, CI hat, to the topos of presheaves on C sigma hat. And of course, for any quotient theory T of sigma, its classifying topos, ET, will be a subtopos of C sigma hat. So this is just because it is a quotient theory. So here we consider axioms. And the pullbacks of this subtoposis, just because of the existence of the pullback operation on subtoposis, is a subtopos of CI hat. But such a subtopos is defined by a topology GIT, which comes from this quotient theory T. And this topology, you can call an extrapolation principle or an interpretation on CI, because this is what allows to define the topos completion of CI, which becomes CI at GIT. So here there is the idea that the interpretation, the understanding we may have about some partial knowledge of some element of reality EI, so this is such an interpretation, comes from language. Okay, so suppose we are in this situation, and you see, the problem we have is that in this situation, we have a joint vocabulary, we have words, but we don't have still axioms. We don't yet know the rules. We would want to determine the rules, to induce the rules, to induce the axioms of T from the elements of reality EI. So this is, in fact, what we want to realize is a form of syntactic learning. We want to learn the syntax, to learn the axioms from examples. Okay, so here is the principle for doing that. We look for a quotient theory T such that if we consider the pullback by the naming functors of the subtopos defined by T, so this defines subtoposes of the CI hat, then each functor from CI to EI has to induce a topos morphism from this topos, from this subtopos, CI hat G, JI T, to EI. And this is, this gives us a criterion for choosing the axioms of T. So in fact, it exactly tells us that we need axioms in order for this condition to be verified. So this is some kind of mathematical model for what I would call inductive reasoning, because the rules will be deduced from the examples, and any rule deduced from any example will apply after that to all other examples. So this is inductive reasoning. And the more examples you will have, the more rules you will be able to deduce. Of course, at this point, you may wonder, but what happens if at some point there are too many derived rules, derived axioms, and the theory collapses, it becomes too poor. For instance, it becomes contradictory. And the answer is absolutely obvious. It is that if we fall into such a situation, what it means is that the vocabulary we started with was too poor. We have to enlarge the vocabulary in order to describe the diversity of cases without collapsing the description language. In fact, if you think about, for instance, the history of science, the history of physics, this is what happened repeatedly. So, for instance, there is classical physics, whose language is based on differential calculus. So it was developed by Newton and following Newton. And for several centuries, it was enough. But then physicists discovered quantum mechanics, quantum phenomena. And it happens that the classical language of physics was not enough. So they had to enlarge the language to replace numbers, in particular, by self-adjoint operators in Hilbert spaces. They needed more room. And here we have a mathematical scheme for this type of development. At some point, you may realize, or the computer applying these rules may realize that the language is too poor. We need more words to describe the diversity of examples, which nevertheless, despite their diversity, belong to the same natural family. Okay, so here I have written at the bottom of the slide the rule for such a theory. You see, the last line, I say that any the classifying topos of such a theory T has to be included into something which is theoretically determined from the examples. So this means that the examples tell you that we need at least some list of axioms. So the axioms are really derived from the examples. So by now, the last part of the talk is just presenting the problem of information extraction. Suppose we are considering elements of reality, EIs, as before. We have partial knowledge on them, incarnated by some topos morphism Ki. So here the letter K is for knowledge. And these toposes are endowed with naming functor, so Ni. So the letter N is for name. And they all go to the classifying topos of a joint description formal language T. So by now, for any I, the image of the naming functor in ET corresponds to a quotient theory TI of T. And this quotient theory can be called the description of the reality EI in the language T. So this is the situation we arrived at. But by now, we would want to extract from this family some type of information phrased in another language T prime. So of course, extraction of information is what we are interested in. For instance, suppose we have a collection of images and we want to answer the question, do these images contain a cat or not? Okay, so this is a typical and of course very challenging example of information extraction. So here we retain the idea that what makes sense is what is well defined in terms of toposes and morphism of toposes. So this means that information in the process of information extraction we are looking at has to be well defined in terms of toposes, subtoposes, and morphism of toposes. So here the first idea would be that it could take the form of a topos morphism from the classifying topos of T to the classifying topos of T prime. So you see, T is a description language for the type of reality we are considering, and T prime is a description language for the type of information we are trying to extract. So why would such a topos morphism be good? It would be good because it would transform any subtopos of ET into a subtopos of ET prime. In other words, it would replace any description of a singular element of reality EI into a singular description phrased in the terms of the description language T prime for the type of information we are trying to extract. So here I make the remark that the process of information extraction could take another form, a more general form, which is a form of so-called correspondences. So what is a correspondence? So here is the definition. So first, there is a remark that for any pair of toposes E1, E2, their product is well defined as a topos. There is a topos E1 times E2, such that to consider a morphism from an arbitrary topos E prime to E1 cross E2 is the same thing as to consider a morphism from E prime to E1 and a morphism from E prime to E2. So this is a classical characterization of products. So products are well defined in the world of toposes. And by now, a correspondence between two toposes E1 and E2 is just a subtopos of the product topos. Just that, usually in topology or geometry, a correspondence is a subspace of the product of two spaces. So we remark that if E1 and E2 are the classifying topologies of two theories T1 and T2, then the product topos is just the classifying topos of the disjoint union of these two theories. So this means the vocabulary is just the sum of the two vocabularies, and the axioms is just the sum of the two families of axioms. Okay, but by now we have that a correspondence, which means a subtopos of this product topos necessarily corresponds to a quotient theory gamma of this sum, disjoint sum of theories, this join of the theories T1 and T2. So this means that by now correspondences take a syntactic form. They are just quotient theories. And by now we remark that anytime you have such a correspondence, E gamma embedded in E1 cross E2, it transforms subtopologies of E1 into subtopologies of E2. The only thing you have to do is to take the pullback of subtopologies by the first projection. You intersect that with the correspondence, and you take the image of that through the second projection. So very classical definition. And of course, we are looking for quotient theories gamma of the join of T and T prime, which would transform subtopologies ETI of ET into subtopologies of ET prime, verifying, of course, some conditions. For instance, we would not want that to we would want to recognize cats, things like that. Okay, and of course, this is here we are, this question is the heart of deep learning. So what we would want is to realize some kind of topos theoretic deep learning. And of course, we remember that the most important and most basic element of deep learning, it consists in constructing functions as composites of functions which are quite simple. So any factor is simple, but the composites may be, of course, much more elaborate. And here we just have the remark that this, of course, makes sense in the world of topologies. We can try to construct a topos morphism as a composite of simpler morphism. Or we can try to construct a correspondence between two theories, between the classifying topologies of two theories as a composite of correspondences. So all of this makes sense. And if we think about the first formulation, so trying to construct a topos morphism as a composite, so this factors, so F index alpha, should relate classifying topologies of some theories, and this morphism could be defined between functors between the syntactic categories. So this can be called syntactic functors, and they should, in that case, they would be defined syntactically. And just if we try to understand what it means, so here you see I have put a definition, just a functor between two syntactic categories, but what does it mean? It just means that we would have two theories, so the previous one and the new one, and such a functor would mean that the vocabulary of the new theory could be expressed in terms of the previous theory, maybe in an elaborate way. So this would correspond exactly to introducing new concepts in terms of previous concepts. Just as, for instance, if you want to write a textbook presenting, for instance, a mathematical domain, you start with basic definitions, and chapter after chapter, you introduce more elaborate definitions, more elaborate results on the basis of what has been done before. So this scheme which would correspond to that. So okay, so this is what we are trying to do. Okay, so but I think I can stop there. So thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you for your talk. And now we have time for questions and discussion. So yeah, you can open your microphone and ask a question. You can also raise your hand. There is more than one person interested. I'll break the ice. What is geometric about geometric theories somehow? Because it's mapped, I mean, it's objects, maps, and relations. To me, it sounds more algebraic. Why are they called geometric?
No, so geometric. So it it means that it is just the meaning was chosen because it is a type of geometric theories for which topomorphism allow to pull back models. So this is the reason. But so this, of course, algebraic theories are geometric. In fact, it is much more general than that. Because even, for instance, if you consider an arbitrary first order theory, you can phrase it in geometric, you can transform it in a, give it a geometric formulation without changing the set valued models. So this means that it is extremely general, and the fact that it is extremely general, this fact, as a consequence, or it can be seen by thanks to this theorem, which says that any topos is classified by a theory, and in fact, not only by a theory, but by infinitely many theories. So this means that this notion of geometric theory is just as general, just as rich as the general notion of topos. Of course, you may wonder, but this is beyond, of course, what I have explained in my talk, but you may wonder what about second order mathematics, third order mathematics, infinite order mathematics. So here, in fact, there is a very nice answer to that, which is the fact that, so as we said, first order mathematics is classified by toposes, but then it can be seen that second order mathematics, so this is second order theories, are classified by what we can call a relative topos. So this means a system consisting of an upper topos fibered over a base topos. So they are classified by a morphism from a topos, which you can consider as a global object, and with a projection to a base topos. And if you want to classify third order theories, you will need a topos over a topos, over a topos. So a chain of three toposes. And more generally, if you want to classify theories of order n, what you would need is a chain of n toposes. So this means that even in order to take care of higher order mathematics, in fact, the world of toposes is enough to do it. And it provides, it gives you a guide for developing logic. Because one of the key, or the most important principle between, the most important fact between, in everything I have explained, is this correspondence on topology or geometry on the one hand, and syntax on the other hand. In computers are syntactic machines. They deal with symbols. Okay? But what we would want to do is to take care of meaning, to take care of the semantics. And here there is a general idea, which in fact had been voiced already many decades ago by some people, so for instance, French mathematician René Thom had already expressed the idea, maybe 50 years ago, that semantic information should take a topological form. But for him, it was just intuition. But here we have a theorem, which in fact had already been proved in the 1970s, but which unfortunately very few mathematicians know, which say that given an arbitrary first order theory put in geometric form, its semantics is incarnated in a topos. So it is incarnated by an object which has topological nature and to which all usual notions and intuitions of topology make sense, including, by the way, usual topological invariants, such that homotopy groups and cohomology spaces. So this is defined in the, for arbitrary toposis. So okay. In fact, this is the first reason why Grothendieck defined toposis. For him, the notion of topos was the most general notion where it was still possible to do homotopy and cohomology.
Okay, so yeah, if someone has a question, please raise your hand. Otherwise, I will keep asking. We are going a bit over time from the idea we had initially, but I mean, it's okay on our side. So if you have some more time for questions, I would be glad to ask. Also, for instance, the models of geometric theories, the way I saw them, they really offer this framework actually to understand math in this very general way. My question is whether they've been also helpful in proving some very big results in math. Say that you could translate something that you did in a very abstract way and then prove something a bit more concrete, or it stops in the understanding?
No, but these models, you see, here with the notion of topos, they are defined in the most general way, but in mathematical practice, in fact, they appear all the time with a more specific vocabulary. So for instance, both mathematicians and physicists are used to deal with bundles, vector bundles, or group bundles.
Bundles are good for me. My question is whether, like, is there something that has been done thanks to the models that people who were working on bundles didn't realize about? And then because of this general framework, someone said, look, but there is something general that you can apply in your situation. This is my question.
Now your question is, were toposis useful for something?
Yeah, if they were like apart from this understanding and this framework, where
no,
there is
so
a good example of
the topos allows
number theory.
So the definition is so general that it allows to transport geometric or topological methods almost everywhere in mathematics. So, for instance, it's this way, thanks to toposis. Grothendieck was able to import in number theory and arithmetic algebraic geometry definitions, notions, invariants, properties, which before belonged only to algebraic topology. And this allowed to prove not only one result, but thousands of results. In fact, all the very deep theorems which were proved in arithmetic algebraic geometry in the last 50 or 60 years were proved thanks to this invariant. And these invariants which were used were defined by Grothendieck as invariants of toposes. They are topos invariants. So in particular, of course, the invariants he studied more than any other are cohomological invariants. But by now, it is important to remark that these are not the only invariants of toposes. So the history of mathematics has made that these invariants have been particularly studied, but many others can be defined. The invariants may be objects attached to toposes, so for instance, cohomology spaces or homotopy groups, but they can also be properties. So you can consider properties of toposes and wonder which toposes verify or don't verify these properties. So you see, for instance, in geometry, an important way, a very important process, which has been used by many people, consists in trying to classify some type of objects. And so geometers try to classify some type of objects. So for instance, I worked in the Langlands program, and in the Langlands program, so what I did is some computations with cohomology spaces of some very interesting geometric objects, which had been introduced by Drinfeld, so-called Drinfeld-Stukas. And by definition, they were classifying some quite elaborate geometric objects. So you see, you construct a geometric object by classifying some type of objects. Okay? In other words, you are classifying models. Okay? But of course, in order for this geometric object to be interesting, you need an interesting theory. Okay? So Drinfeld introduced a classification problem of new objects, he called Stukas, and this classification problem has a solution. They are classified by a so-called scheme, a classifying scheme of Stukas, and this classifying scheme is very interesting. So this is classical geometry. But if you allow toposes in general, here you have a theorem which tells you that whatever the classification problem you have, there is always a classifying space. But of course, what it means is, so you don't have anymore an existence problem, because this classifying space always exists. But the question you may have, the question you necessarily have, is, okay, this classification space is there. What can I say about it? What are its properties? Okay? So okay. It is always it is an incredibly general solution result for classification problems. But here, what we have is that so when we do mathematics, we know, when we do geometry, we know that the interesting geometric objects are classifying objects. Okay, so this is mathematical experience. So my talk today was not on that side. It was on the side of relating syntax and semantics. Because in fact, this is why these people at Huawei, which I met 7 years ago, got interested first into what I was explaining about toposes, because it provided a link, a theoretical link, between syntax and semantics.
Yeah, and I have questions about that.
We are working on that. This is, you see, several years after, 7 years after that, we are just trying to go deeper and deeper into that direction.
Okay, so yeah, I understand some people may have to leave, but I wanted to take this unique opportunity to ask you some questions also about this part of your of your talk. So somehow here you started from the mathematical viewpoint, because actually this activity is for mathematicians as well. But imagine you had to explain toposis to a person who knows like about neural networks and classifiers and reinforcement learning. So can you do a very easy somehow explanation to them, or is it still like difficult or it's very challenging?
No, at some point, of course, you need to. You see, for instance, if you are a computer scientist, you are working at the syntactic level. So in some sense, you can do everything without knowing the notion of topos, except that, as I said, what makes sense is what is well-defined at the notion of toposis. So this is, you see, the problem of syntax is that everything is possible with syntax. You see, if you don't have a guide, you are lost. Because any list of symbols belongs to syntax. So there is too much freedom. So you need a criterion to discriminate between what makes sense and what does not make sense. And the relationship of syntax and semantics through toposis provides you with this guide. Furthermore, there is the aspect that the topos theory is by definition and by development, it is entirely constructive. So this means that it is theoretically computable. So of course, theoretically computable does not mean that it is that computations can always be implemented. Okay, but at least theoretically, everything is computable. And after that, to try to implement things concretely, it is complicated. It needs what is really needed is joint work between pure mathematicians and computer scientists. So this is what we are trying to do. Here, of course, what I presented to you is a theoretical picture.
Yeah, I actually have seen some slides, I guess, from your colleagues. I think it was Jean-Claude Del Fiore.
Yes.
Talking about actually 6G and topos theory. So somehow, how close are we to have
no this is because so CG is something under development, but so this is, you see, 5G was about communication and so on, but 6G has to integrate AI, and just in order, for instance, to reduce the amount of information which has to be transmitted and things like that. And it also has to go in the direction of semantic information. So in fact, if I talk to my colleagues, including Jean-Claude, in fact, they consider that the most important question, the most important theoretical question for the future development of AI is to have a good theory of semantic information. The existing theory of information by Shannon does not say anything about semantics. It is just syntactic. Okay? So the question is how to discriminate between what makes sense and what does not make sense, in order to become much more efficient. So by now, we have these huge AI processes, but they are not efficient precisely for that reason. And so we need to progress to build a theory of semantic information. And so for them, what they know about topos theory gives them the conviction, they become convinced that Topos theory opens the door to solve this problem. First, because of the theorem I stated, this theorem which dates back to the 1970s. But of course, everything has to be implemented. Here, what I have explained is just the beginning. It is just to give an idea that indeed there is something interesting to explore.
And very last question. How was moving from IHS to Huawei? How was moving somehow to like this very purely mathematical research? I mean, this is also very purely mathematical, but you are somehow, you have a target. Can you comment on that?
In fact, I can say I have been surprised by my discovery of the world of engineers. So in particular, by now I realize that even 7 years ago or before, I had the idea that applied mathematics was very limited, that it was limited to numerical analysis, probability theory, statistics, maybe PDEs. But I realized that by now, a much bigger part of mathematics has become and becomes every day more and more interesting for engineers. So the applicability of mathematics has increased in an incredible way. And of course, engineers, most of the time, were not educated as mathematicians, but at least part of them, are very open-minded. And I was also baffled by that. So for example, you have made an allusion to Jean-Claude, so Jean-Claude Belfior. So I think that by now he's 60 or 59. And beginning 7 years ago, because of what he discovered, thanks to a talk I had given, he decided to learn category theory and topos theory from scratch. So this is amazing for me. That engineers, or some engineers at least, can be so open-minded, including to very theoretical developments. So this means that for me, so leaving IHS and by now working at Huawei, so to be honest, my life did not change a lot. But I am also surprised about that engineers or an engineer company can be so positive and so interested by pure mathematics.
Okay. So, well, thank you for everything. Thank you for your inspirational talk in this mind-blowing subject, and also for all the answers to my questions. That's all for today. Thanks also for staying overtime, and for the rest of the audience, or the people who may watch the video, the ones who had to leave earlier, remember that we'll have two more talks in March and April. And that's all for today. So thanks a lot for joining.
Okay, thanks again.